Uni made two commercials. I could tell experimentalist talks are all commercials. The entire thing is a, the entire half of my talk is a commercial. So, okay, so I'm going to be essentially covering results from EXO 200 and then lead you into an EXO. Since this is the first experimental talk on neutrino decay, double beta decay, which is something you know has been already discussed from the theory end yesterday and today, I'll spend the first couple of slides giving, orienting you about the challenges and what's difficult. So those modern experiments need isotopic enrichment, and that means that except for maybe tellurium, but otherwise you need to go through a enrichment phase. Present experiments with a about 100 kilogram sort of class of material, you know, quantity of material, and we're talking about ton scale experiments for sort of quantities for experiments under planning. You need to go underground because you need to actually shield cosmic rays. You need to use very low radioactivity materials in order to suppress the background or to have low background. And in modern experiments, and I'll spend much more time on this in a minute, you also need to try to invent as much as possible new techniques to discriminate between signal and background. This is, of course, very hard because we're doing this. You know, this is not LHC. Everything is very small energy deposits. So this is challenging. And so, in fact, I want to elaborate a little bit on this last point here. So modern experiments, different experiments to a different extent, but they use the energy measurement, which of course for the neutrino-less decay, you're supposed to get a monochromatic line, so that's a powerful discriminant. And in fact, for small detectors or for previous generation detectors, this was essentially all there was. But then now you can also use event multiplicity, particularly in homogeneous detectors, because that gives you the ability of seeing gammas that, for the most part, undergo Compton scattering with the, strange enough, the two electrons that actually give us, you know, a very concentrated energy deposit, even if there's two of them. You also, the detectors, I'll show you more, show a cartoon about this, but can actually, at this point, becomes large enough that you can see the attenuation of external gamma ray radiation as you go deeper and deeper in the detector. And then many detectors are also able to do alpha discrimination. I think it's a, we should be all quite proud, experimentalists, that in the last generation we've really managed to turn on many of those things in some cases at the same time. So the now actually transitioning to the EXO program, we've actually started working on with liquid xenon, and in particular double beta decay in 136 xenon now for a while, initially studying energy resolution in liquid xenon and improving it. Then we built EXO 200, that was actually the first 100 kilogram class experiment to take data and produce results. I'll show you some data from this. And then now we're planning to build a ton scale detector that we call Nexo, that may have some interesting upgrade path for the future, but I probably won't have time to talk about that. So the idea, the way this works is those are liquid xenon TPCs, so there's pretty much nothing in the bulk of the liquid xenon. And you can see here, this is half of EXO 200. There is usually a cathode up here that is not mounted in this picture. There are fish shaping rings, and then there are grids collecting the ionization at the bottom there, and avalanche photodiodes in EXO 200 that actually detect the scintillation light. That happens at an inconvenient wavelength of 175 nanometers. The energy resolution is improved by measuring both the scintillation energy and the ionization energy because the two of them are anticorrelated, as you can see here. So you really want to go along this axis here, which is sort of diagonal, where the resolution is the best. And you can see also here, this what we call rotated energy resolution at this point in EXO 200 is 1.2%. But if you only use scintillation or ionization, this is not as good. The detector can also suppress alphas because, again, in the ratio between ionization and scintillation light, now I'm actually showing this thing for low background data, so this is actually same as the previous correlation plot, but this is done not for a source. Sorry, this was actually a calibration source. This is now done for low background data. You may wonder in the low background data what this big blob is. Well, that's the two neutrino decay. That happens a lot in this relatively large detector. Now, if you zoom out from this picture here, up here, in a region where there's a lot of scintillation light and very little ionization, you actually get the alphas that have higher density of ionization. So it's very easy to actually discriminate alphas in this detector. Now, but the most important discrimination is between what we call single-site and multi-site events. Those are the, so you have, if you want, we're showing here low background data that is dominated by the 2 neutrino double beta decay, and a source data that is down here. This is what we call single cluster or single site. This is multi-cluster. And you can see that the double beta decay, for the most part, goes into the single cluster bucket, if you want. And the gamma rays mostly go into the multiple site bucket because they produce, the detector is large enough to make lots of quantum scattering. So actually, the final fitting to signal and background knows about all of this stuff and fits and finds the best combination of signal and background. You're measuring really the background and the signal simultaneously in this way. EXO-200 took data for a couple of years. And I'll show you a summary of results later in a couple of slides. Then we had an unfortunate accident in the mine that has nothing to do with us, but there was a fire in the mine, and then there was even a radioactivity release by the jokers who actually ran the disposal site, nuclear dump, whatever the thing is. And so we were essentially off for, I don't know, a year and a half or so. And then we actually went underground, or started going underground again, recovered, cleaned up, and turned on the detector again at the beginning of 2016. So at this point, a year and a half, almost 2 years ago. And you can see that actually, I would say, in my opinion, somewhat surprisingly, the electron lifetime of the detector that was very good was between 2 and 3 milliseconds in the old data, picked up, these are days after you turn on, as with the same time constant, the same behavior that was before. And the radon background in the detector, every time you refill, so during the accident, we had to recover the xenon into high pressure cylinders, warm up the detector, because we essentially were kicked out of the mine and we had to do all these things from remote. But we were just worried that there would be a power outage and then we would lose everything. And so we had to, you know, putting xenon back in the detector, you also bring some radon in from the atmosphere, and this decays with the well-known half-life. And it actually settles down to the steady state value of 4.2 microbecquerel per kilogram, which is identical, actually, within two significant digits to the old one. This is kind of a combination. I imagine it's not, doesn't have to be exactly the same number. But anyway, it's essentially the same. The new analysis is actually somewhat improved from the old one. So now there's essentially one more year of data with respect to the data that was published before. And in fact, as much as possible, also retroactively with the old data, we use, the new data has better energy resolution because we have essentially improved the electronic system. And then there is an analysis that is applied both to the old data and the new data. That actually goes into single-site events and try to see whether you can actually do better at rejecting more background of the background that is still left to the single-site events. And this is done essentially by looking at things like signal rise time, which is lower in the case of gammas because, again, also in the z direction, sometimes those things are multiple clusters. And so you can see that the cluster is a little bit fatter. And so the rise time of the event is slower. And also this the ratio between 1 and 2 channels, 1 and 2 wires, if you want, in the energy deposit. And again, that's actually trying to see how fat the event is and how gamma-like or electron-like is. And so you actually build one of those machine learning sort of discriminators with this thing, and you can further reject 35% of background in the single site data, only losing 10% of the signal. So you improve somewhat the situation. This is the spectrum. Those plots are quite busy, so I'm not sure it's very useful. It's in the paper, so actually that's the better way to look at it. But this is the region where you expect to see a peak if there is the decay. Let me give you the result that is here. So at this point, the sensitivity is 3.7 10 to the 25 years at 90% confidence level. And the half-life limit is 1.8 10 to the 25 years. This is really, the sensitivity is really the correct way we claim to actually estimate how well the detector is doing, not so much the background index, because the background index doesn't know about the other, it only rejects event, you know, only gives you the background reject events on the basis of the energy resolution, and there's more to it because there's the other, all the other variables we're using. But if you want the background index, it's actually pretty good. This 1.5 × 10⁻³ per kilogram year KV. Now, I think I want to show, instead of concentrating, I mean, those are limits, so the numbers are not particularly interesting once they're limits. But it's maybe more interesting to actually put them in some sort of context with other things. First of all, we just, as a, an example, with germanium, one can do the same plot for tellurium. I just didn't have time or space to actually put all of these things together. But so you can see the situation with Kamlan-Zen and us. The sensitivity are the vertical lines, and the limits are the arrows. So you can see that Kamlan-Zen was, I hate actually, my students say, well, they were lucky. I mean, you're lucky when you actually see the decay, and so when you get the worst possible limit. but if you're really into limits, well, you know, Kamlan-Zen was kind of lucky because they had presumably some sort of deficit of events in the respect to the background model. And we were quite sort of, I guess, on the other hand, unlucky because we have a little bit of an excess of events, which is what you should try to have, in a sense, or you'd be happy about. Anyway, I just wanted to actually, since we've been oscillating about being lucky and unlucky, I actually, for the three publications of EXO 200, the last one, by the way, was actually put on the preprint in July. And I'm showing here, so for those three publications, this is the exposure in kilogram years. And I'm showing here the limits, if you want. Those are the white bullets. The sensitivity with the 68% confidence level interval around them. And also the sensitivity projection using the analysis we used at the beginning in the first analysis here. So actually, you can get a number of sort of information, you know, a piece of information from this. First of all, you see that our limit is not changing much here because of fluctuations. On the other hand, the sensitivity is increasing steadily. And also, the sensitivity does better than just statistics. And that's because we're improving the analysis. We're not just accumulating more data. In fact, we're improving the detector with the better resolution and the analysis. Okay? So that's actually the summary. Unfortunately, the fact that we have a little excess doesn't mean we have a signal. You can see that within a sigma, essentially, we're consistent with the null hypothesis. All right, so now switching into the future. At least in the US, but I mean worldwide, there is consensus that moving to ton-scale experiments is really the next logical step, and this is a very high priority. In fact, in the US nuclear science community, this is the highest priority. It's listed two because number one is you know, exploit existing infrastructure, which is great, of course, that's natural. But this is the first new initiative here. And so now moving forward, I want to sort of step back 1 second and actually see a little bit how you, you know, what is the rational way of moving forward, what the real issues are. And the first thing is that I want to actually, you know, contrast this with dark matter experiments where our colleagues are, you know, I say that we are either much better or much more stupid because our background is much harder to deal with. Trouble is that when you're doing dark matter searches, you're really optimized for very low energy. And what I'm showing here from the PDG is the cross-section for interacting, for photon interactions, and you know, down to sub-KV energies, which is what the dark matter colleagues are interested in. And you see those cross-sections are very large. So a very thin skin of your material shields the inside from the radioactivity coming, you know, from the gamma rays coming from the outside. And double beta decay, on the other hand, is in this MEV regime where the cross section has a minimum, if anything. Okay? And so it's very hard to shield those gamma rays, and that means that those detectors have to be intrinsically much cleaner. On the other hand, I'm claiming that we're really entering, it's funny enough, as the detector is getting larger, some people tell you, well, this is crazy, and so on. Well, actually, it's not crazy, it's getting better, because now the size of the detector is much larger than the interaction length of gamma rays. This is actually shown here for xenon, but this is, you know, you can show it for any of those materials. It's sort of pretty much the same thing. So this is for liquid xenon. I have a little round thing here that represents a sphere with mass, what I'm, you know, what is shown here. So those are the old experiments, like the Gösgen experiment, the Gotthard experiment. This is actually EXO 200, and this is NEXO. And the little line is the attenuation length of a 2.5 MeV gamma ray.
And you see that in the old detectors, Compton scattering looks the same as electrons, because you only get one scattering in your detector, and so they're all single site. XO200 can use this rejection of photons by looking at Compton scattering much better. By the time you get into Nexo, not only you can do that, but also you can see substantial attenuation of the radiation that is coming from the outside. And so deeper parts, different depth in the detector measure different things, measure different ratio between signal and background, really. All right, so of course, this is not the way you build a larger EXO detector. You don't put together 25 XO200s. This would be actually, in some sense, trivial. You can even get sort of General Motors to do it for you, like they do cars. Or maybe Toyota, that's even better, actually. But this is not the way to do it. You have to go back and redesign it much larger, because you want to take advantage of the fact that you have this bulk of liquid xenon with nothing else but liquid xenon in it. So that's actually a comparison between the two detectors. Also, XO200 for accidental reasons and an horizontal axis that is stupid for a cryogenic detector. You want to hang this thing usually. It's just that we didn't have overhead space in the mine, so we couldn't do it. So Nexo now is built like, is designed like a real thing. We discovered that Exo Lagos had already used the name Nexo, which is, I don't know if it's good or bad, but anyway. And so this is the way it looks like in a typical cavern. This happens to be the Snowab cryopit. And so you see that the detector is sitting inside a cryostat, which is with a vacuum insulation between. There is actually this volume here, like in XO200, is filled with this HFE 7000 fluid, which is used both to keep the temperature very uniform around the liquid xenon, to cool the liquid xenon, and to shield the liquid xenon from the radiation from the outside. This is the cleanest innermost layer of shielding, and it turns out that this HFE 7000 is pretty much the cleanest thing, other than liquid xenon, is the cleanest thing we've ever measured. So it's very good sort of for the innermost layer of shielding. So that's actually a detail of this. We've essentially decided to get rid of the cathode in the middle, because again, we are appreciating more and more how important it is to have this very large bulk of xenon with nothing in it. So now we are drifting electrons for 1.3 meters, which is, I think, quite doable, but it's, you know, it's a bit more challenging than the 25 centimeters of XO200. There is a number of changes, and I cannot go through all the R&D topics and all the things that we are doing, but I'll just give you a couple of examples. XO200 had avalanche photodiodes to read out the scintillation light. We're switching now to VUV-sensitive silicon photomultipliers. There's going to be about 4 square meters of it, and for a time we have a small array like this that we just put together with diodes that are good enough to do the job. And in fact, these are actually some parameters of those diodes, like the photon detection efficiency here at this wavelength. And these are essentially the correlated avalanches in a particular time interval. And that's complicated how this thing really works, but enough to say that we need to be in here. And now we start having devices made by some companies that actually start being in there. For the time being, just barely so. In the next couple of years, we expect to really go well in between, in the middle here. Charge readout in XO200 is done with those grids. When the grid becomes very large, it also becomes sort of clumsy. You have to temperature cycle it and so on. And also, Nexo will have electronics in the liquid xenon. And so at this point, the idea is to actually build arrays of strips that are crossed on a quartz substrate or silica substrate, which has a number of advantages. There's no tension to hold. It's generally lighter because there's no frame to actually hold those things. And it's modular. Each tile, we call those things tiles, has a chip that does the readout and ships digital data out. And so in general, we have much fewer cables. And we think this will actually provide the lower background sort of environment. This is a detail of those strips. They are designed so that they cover as much as possible the quartz, because we're worried about charge buildup. But they actually cross at some sort of very narrow regions so that we keep the capacitance down, capacitance between strips at a very small level, that is shown here. We have one of those tiles. We have several of those tiles, but you can see one of those tiles mounted in a test setup in liquid xenon. And you can see an example of signals coming out of this thing. The readout of this thing is a little bit tricky because there's no fridge grid in front. And so you essentially get signals that that the rays very slowly as the charge approaches from far away. So you have to learn how to do this. But actually, as of today, there is a paper on the archive that you can go check out with the performance of the system. This is sort of the bottom line for the time being. And you see the resolution for a 570 kV gamma at the bismuth 207 source. And this is essentially the same resolution everybody else gets. For charge only, this device for the time being doesn't have light readout. There's only a small photomultiplier to give T0. Soon we'll have actually that array of of silicon photomultipliers I showed you a few slides ago will go in this system, and so we'll have both light and charge readout with essentially a small version of the entire detector. So also today, funny enough, those two things happen at the same time. We have posted this, a paper, the master paper, essentially describing the sensitivity and discovery potential of Nexo. So this is going to be a benchmark paper for the next few years, and where we actually analyze the sensitivity of the Hall detector. I think I of course this is the commercial unit. This is essentially one thing that I want to stress here is that we don't assume anything new. The model is built using materials that have all been measured. I can actually produce pieces that actually will go in the detector and will provide and will give the resolution, you know, the performance and the sensitivity that is derived here. There's nothing, there's nowhere I have to say, well, you know, we need to improve this. This is all in hand. Now, of course, I don't have all the copper in hand and all the material for doing this thing. I only have samples of it, but there is proof of existence of each piece of material that goes in there. There is a small exception to this, and that is this footnote here. There is one leap of faith. We're claiming that the EXO200 electro lifetime, that is 3 milliseconds, will become 10 milliseconds in Nexo. I think just by surface to volume ratio, that should be quite comfortable. In addition, EXO200 has lots of plastics in it, and Nexo is designed with much less plastics in it. So I think this is very comfortable, but this is actually one area in which we need a little sort of something better. Okay, so what goes in the model is the geometry with all the components and the radioactivity that is measured on existing materials. As I said, some cases we're using measurements of materials used in EXO200, and in other cases we have new materials that we have acquired and measured now. And then, of course, it goes in it, you're confident that the GEAM knows how to do Compton scattering, essentially, which I think is quite conservative. Although our screening, these are actually for different materials, the sort of backgrounds in a full width of max around the Q value. And you can see there is a rather extensive set of elements that compose the detector. Some of them have radioactivity measured. Others, although the techniques have improved, only have upper limits. So in those cases, particularly in the one that is up here, there might be improvements. You know, the background can be lower once we finally really get the value for this than what is predicted by this model. So in order to actually see how the system works, you can actually, it's probably better to actually look at something like this, where I have the energy spectrum for single site and multiple site events showing the background, the two neutrino mode, that is the light blue thing here, and the brown peak is the neutrino SDK for 10 years of data with a half-life of 5.7, 10 to 27 years. And this is shown for the entire detector for the inner 3 tons, inner 2 tons, and inner 1 ton. And so you see that, of course, as you go deeper in the detector, the signal becomes more prominent with respect to the background. But again, the FIT knows about all these things and sort of arranges them in the best possible way. Now, so in general, this background index is not something we like much because there's no single number, and also that doesn't keep into account how the FIT works. But just out of curiosity, if you want to see this, essentially the way the FIT works is that the outermost xenon mostly measures the background, the innermost xenon mostly measures the signal, and then the overall FIT fits both the signal and background the same way at the same time, and so that's how you get the sensitivity. Anyway, the background index, if you go, this is a function of the fiducial mass in here. And so if you actually go below, if you take the innermost 3 tons out of 4.8 or whatever the total number is, you get that this background index is better than 10 to the minus 3 per full liter max kilogram year. Okay, so that's the kind of background that we've been discussing. And this is all done with the existing materials. Okay, so now the sensitivity, as you turn on your detector, and you keep increasing your lifetime, the sensitivity and the discovery potential are shown here, almost invisible because of poor choice of fonts or whatever, is the current XO200 sensitivity. And as you go up here, you see that after 10 years, the sensitivity of Nexo becomes almost 10 to the 28 at 90% confidence level. I hope I impressed upon you that this is a conservative way of doing things. That's what we call baseline. And we've done here parametric study trying to essentially make the prediction a little bit more aggressive, particularly using this analysis here uses the, if you want, remember when I showed you XO200 results, I showed you sensitivity from the first analysis, and then I said, well, you know, we're doing better now. We're still using the first analysis because the neural net thing is too complicated for this thing, and we don't feel like we understand it well enough to apply it here. And so there is space for improvement, and if you apply some of the improvements here, that this 9.2 10 to the 27 becomes something which is a bit more than 10 to the 28 that is shown there. If you only had the two neutrino background in the experiment, then you'll be up here at 4 10 to the 28 sensitivity. So that's what could happen if we manage to actually identify barium atoms in there and look at the final state. And this is just very quick in our R&D. You can see essentially that we can clearly see a signal from a few atoms. In this case, it's something like less than 4 atoms. And the background is sort of good and low. But let me actually go to my final thing so that Manfred doesn't get too excited. So this is actually back to this baseline sensitivity shown with the bands from the, in terms of effective Majorana masses. And again, you see the old XO200 result, the new XO200 result, and 10 years of Nexo data here. And this assumes unquenched EA, because I don't know yet how to do otherwise for the time being. And okay, conclusion. So XO200 is the first 100 kilogram scale detector to take data and produce results. Round 2 is in progress with new results, and we're making progress. This is clearly the way to go for a very large detector, we feel. And we are actually quite advanced in the R&D and the estimate of the sensitivity of a Phyton Nexo detector. Which may have actually some upgrade path also in a second phase with this barium tagging going to over quite a bit over 4, 10 to 28 years of half-life. And I'll just leave with my collaborators here. Thank you.
So, thank you.